طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Good morning everybody, and we will start the first session. But first I hope I would like to thank the organizing committee for inviting us to participate in this very wonderful symposium. I hope we'll continue the good scientific meeting today. I am sure you will enjoy all the sessions. Now it is my pleasure to invite the first speaker, who is Dr. Nafa' al-Harbi, a well-known senior pediatric nephrologist in the kingdom. I'm sure you will enjoy his talking about typical hemolytic uremic syndrome. Dr. Nafa', please. And I hope we stick to the time. We'll be rigid in the time today.
بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Good morning everybody. I will try to be as quick as I can and stick to the time. As probably all of us know that hemolytic uremic syndrome has been becoming quite common, and in the developed country, in the United States, Canada, and some of Europe, it has been labeled as the commonest cause probably of acute renal failure in children. And the number of cases has been increased for some reason or other. And it's not a rare disease. The incidence has been mentioned in the literature to be around 5 in 100,000 of children aged 1 to 5 years of age. This incidence might go up in certain area, like in Argentina, it might be doubled, in fact. And in some places, the incidence seems to be much less. Before we going through the topic, I think it's just to be a good idea to just think about the history of hemolytic uremic syndrome. And if we think back, the history of hemolytic uremic syndrome probably started in 1925 when they first discovered first group which is might be have some relation to HUS, that the thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura, which have some relation, although it's not the same as hemolytic uremic syndrome, but this was the start. And then probably 30 years later, HUS was first time labeled as a triad of syndrome, and that was by Gesser 1955. Another 30 years later, on there was a discovery that some of the defect of the von Willebrand protein is a cause for one of these patients with TTB. And probably within 3 or 5 years later, there was an outbreak in, after ingestion of hamburger in the United States. And that caused an outbreak of several cases. And later on, in 1985, first hemolytic uremic syndrome was discovered to be caused by certain type of E. coli secreting certain type of toxin. So this is the, was the first hemolytic uremic syndrome in children related to E. coli secreting the ferrocyte toxin. As all of us know that hemolytic uremic syndrome is a triad of three things, hemolytic anemia and thrombocytopenia, in addition to acute renal failure. A recent classification of hemolytic uremic syndrome according to the causative process has been published And as you can see, it could be related to infectious problem, or it could be related to complement disorder, or it could be related to funnel gland problem and defect in cobalamin, or it could be sometimes related to certain drugs and to other unknown or unclear pathophysiology, like in malignancy, HIV, and some familial cases. This morning, I will be talking mainly about the hemolytic uremic syndrome related to infectious causes. And if we go back to the hemolytic uremic syndrome, it seems to be it's a subgroup of a large group called TMA, the thrombotic microangiopathic disease, where it's caused by several factors, including malignancy, drugs, lupus, sepsis, and multiple factors. And a group of this disease is the hemolytic uremic syndrome, which can be divided into hemolytic uremic syndrome preceded by a prodrome of diarrhea in 90% of hemolytic uremic syndrome, and atypical form, which is not related to diarrhea or not preceded by diarrhea. And the number of cases of this type has been going up recently, and this one may be staying the same incidence. So the two main types, as we can see, either related to diarrhea, preceded by diarrhea, and then it will be labeled as causing agent as a Shigella toxin-like, where 90%, and only 10% probably related, as I mentioned, to a non-infectious cause. Now I'll just I'll be talking mainly about the hemolytic uremic syndrome, which is related to the bacteria released some types of toxin, which is toxic to the capillary in different places of the body. This nice, probably good bacteria for human being, and in addition to animals, cattle, sometimes changed due to one reason or other, change to be a nasty and very bad bacteria. This is a normal flora, usually the E. coli. And once it is infected by a prophage, which will give certain genetic material, which will be integrated in the genetic material of the bacteria, then the bacteria will become very bad, become a toxin-producing bacteria, and this will be toxic to the species which contain the receptors. So this bacteria might be inside the bowel of the cattle or the animal, and it will not affect this animal because that animal does not have the receptor for this toxin. And it will be, the animal will be carrying this organism harmless and passing it to the human being. The human being, most of the time, they contain the receptor, and it will cause a disease in them. If we look at the toxin, this Shigella-like toxin or Shigella toxin, it seems to be consisting of two subunits, subunit A and subunit of B. This is five types of protein, which is mainly related to the receptor, which will gonna attach to the receptor and fix this toxin to the receptors until it do its job of affecting the cells of the bowel or the capillary. This part is the most important part, which is gonna affect the bowel or the capillary and cause some damage. This is the toxic part of this Shiga toxin. And this is the part most of the work has been done on regarding the vaccine, production of the vaccine, production of the antibody, protective antibody, in the lab to protect these children or prevent the disease in them. So this is mainly for the receptor, and this is causing the toxicity. Shigella dysentery was the first organism probably discovered long time ago, and it was producing the Shiga toxin. They call it the true Shiga toxin protein. And this Shiga toxin is have similar toxin produced by these E. coli. As we said, once the E. coli acquired that infection by a prophage, by a virus, then it will produce a toxin which is almost similar to the Shiga toxin. And it might be better to call this a Shiga-like toxin. A Shiga-like toxin is almost the same as Shigella toxin, but it's only the difference, probably they were saying, it's one only difference in one amino acid. So this E. coli will produce the Shiga-like toxin, and if it is infected, and it will pass the infection to other bacteria also, like Citrobacter, which is going to probably cause the same problem and secrete the same toxin. The Shiga toxin, the true toxin, or the Shiga-like toxin, has been found to be two types. And it might be important to understand the pathophysiology of the disease, to understand these two types and what the difference between the two. And I will come later to the difference between the two, but I just want to mention one thing here, that the ferrocyte toxin or the ferrotoxin seems it's almost the same as Shiga toxin. When they discovered the Shiga-like toxin, they were testing it on a African green monkey's kidney cells, and they give it the name as a ferrocyte because it was toxic to these cells. So if you see the term ferrocyte toxin or ferrotoxin, it's almost the same as Shiga-like toxin or Shigella toxin. As I mentioned before, that Shigella toxin or Shiga-like toxin is two types. The most important type is the Shiga toxin type 2, which seems to be quite a potent toxin, causing most of the disease, and it's 400 times as toxic as Shiga toxin 1. And most of the work has been done also on Shiga toxin type 2. Seems to be causing the disease, and seems to be the most work, the preventive antibody, the vaccination, all on Shigella toxin 2. I just want to mention that the bacteria, which is any serotypes of E. coli, can produce both. You can find the organism producing have the ability to produce the two toxin, Shiga toxin 1 and Shiga toxin 2. And would it produce cause the disease of hemolytic uremic syndrome? It depends on how much would it secrete of Shiga toxin 1 or Shiga toxin 2. If it is producing more Shiga toxin 1, then probably it might cause mild disease, or probably it will be asymptomatic. But if it is causing secreting Shiga toxin 2, then it will cause the serious disease. Not all the bacteria, as I said, not all the serotypes of E. coli producing this toxin. Some serotypes are benign and not producing the toxin, and this will be not causing any disease. But the most common types, which is seen in the state causing the hemolytic uremic syndrome, was the O157H7. And the O referred to the somatic antigen, and the H for the flagellar antigen. So they give them a number according to what type of antigen this bacteria have. So in the States seems to be more common, this serotype. In other places, like in Europe, it's 026. And in Australia, it seems to be a different serotypes also causing the disease. And it's interesting enough that if you look at the flora in the cattle they have there in Australia, the 0157 is quite common in their cattle's bowel, but it's not causing the disease in their area. So it seems to be this is a benign type in this area, although it is other types causing the disease. How the disease reach the body or the pathophysiology is starting from the animal. The animal will contain these organisms, which is as a normal flora, and it's not causing any problem to this animal. And once it's reached the human being by either contamination of vegetables, milk, or meat, or even hand-to-hand transmission from one person to another, it will cause the disease. This bacteria, I have to mention that it's resistant to the environmental factors like heat, and it can stay in the soil for a long time, and then will be transmitted to the human being. Once it's transmitted to the human being, within 3 to 5 days, especially in children, it will cause the bowel problem and diarrhea, and then later on, within 7 to 10 days, it will cause some capillary changes in those who are susceptible, and it will cause the hemolytic uremic syndrome. Usually, the hemolytic uremic syndrome preceded by a prodrome of diarrhea, which starts after 3 or 5 days after ingestion of the organism, and then followed by bloody diarrhea, and then it will be followed by hemolytic uremic syndrome, and then the sequelae of the hemolytic uremic syndrome. Usually these children will have diarrhea for 3 or 5 days, and this diarrhea will be either bloody or non-bloody. And during this time, they will have some abdominal pain, fever in 30% of them, and then they might recover a little bit, and after this, they will start having edema and pallor and oliguria, and the sign and symptoms of hemolytic uremic syndrome will start. Not all children who get the organism or ingested the organism will have the hemolytic uremic syndrome. And people looked at what could be the cause. Why not all children who have the diarrhea or have the organism will not have the hemolytic uremic syndrome? And it seems to be related to several factors. One of the factors is the age. And the age, because of the antibodies. Once these children acquire the antibody for this toxin, then probably they will have, even if they have the organism, it will be asymptomatic, without any symptoms. And they thought that the organism acquired by children and acquired by old age, because old age usually they lose the antibody when by time. So they are prone to develop the disease. Also, they found it could be related to the type of the toxin, as we mentioned before, toxin 1 or toxin 2. Once they have a large dose of toxin 2 or the bacteria, they were lucky, the bacteria producing only toxin 1, then probably they will have a mild disease or they don't have a disease. But if it is toxin 2, then they will have the disease. Also, they think it depends on the dose of the bacteria they ingested, in addition to some genetic factors which might be related to some changes in their protection system, the immunology system, like factor H and other factors. So the A, genetic factors, the dose of the bacteria, and the serotypes of bacteria also quite important to cause the disease. Use of antibiotics, I will come later on to this. But once the organism enters the system and the process of hemolytic uremic syndrome will start, the child will be thrombocytopenic, will have renal damage, sclerosis, and nephron loss, and renal failure. What we do to diagnose this problem, usually we start with a simple thing, CBC, looking for a platelet, which might be missed sometimes because it come and disappear quickly. Then we look at a blood smear to confirm that it's hemolytic angiopathic anemia. And we look at the renal profile to make sure that the creatinine is not rising up quickly. To diagnose, to confirm what could be the cause, we do a stool culture, but the organism, this type of E. coli seems to be quite difficult to grow. And you have to have a special media and you have to notify the lab that you're looking for this organism. And in most of the study done in our countries and developed and developing country, they didn't probably isolate this organism, and the only organism they isolate probably is the Shigella, because this organism, as I mentioned, is quite difficult to grow. Then once we grow the organism, we do the serotyping to find out what serotypes is that, and then it's not enough here, because we have to know if this organism producing the toxin or not. If it's not producing the toxin, it will not be the cause for this hemolytic anemic syndrome. So we test, they collect the stool and they look for the toxin, and they tested the toxin for the gene of STX1 or 2, and then they might have a BioStar test, which is a quick test to detect the toxin. Treatment of the disease after the diagnosis is usually is not difficult, and we should start with prevention, which is more important than treating the disease itself. And the most important thing is hand washing and good cooking of all vegetables, and also the meat should be good, cooked very well to avoid this organism. When I come to treatment, I will just mention briefly that it seems to be in the start supportive treatment regarding the anemia. We treat the hemoglobin if it drops quite down, below 6. And also, we might give them platelet, but we have to be careful when we use platelet, because you might feed up the disease and create more problem. We have to be careful about their fluid, and if they need dialysis, they should be treated early to avoid complication of uremia. Also, if they develop some CNS problem, complication should be treated and take care of that regarding the anti-seizure medication. Hypertension also should be kept in mind and should be treated when it's raised up. This is just a quick look at how effective or how bad the use of the antibiotics in these children. There have been several studies showing that the use of antibiotics during the diarrheal phase seems to increase the risk of hemolytic anemic syndrome. But in fact, there was other few studies which is not supporting this. I'm mentioning that it might help children with hemolytic anemic syndrome and decrease the complications.
3 minutes you have.
Okay, I'm almost done. This is a recent study where they're collecting all the papers talking about the effect of antibiotics on this disease. And as you can see, any number which is crossing one or crossing or near to the line here, if the odd ratio around one or crossing one, this means the risk is not high, or it's almost equal, because they're comparing the risk of having the antibiotic, the HUS after antibiotics and without antibiotics. So if it is one, the risk is one, or the odd ratio is one, this means there is no risk of using antibiotics. So most of the study, even if you pull them together, seems to be not a very risky way of treating these children. So this study, the meta-analysis study, showing that probably it's not clear that use of antibiotic create a problem for these children. So the latest probably recommendation is, just because we don't have a clear decision on this, we have to avoid the use of antibiotic, especially for E. coli. But in other countries where we have the Shigella, which is, seems to be quite invasive organism, we might use antibiotics to treat these children and minimize the effect. This is just a quick look at the the publication in this regard in the Saudi children, and there has been four cases. First four cases were 1989, unpublished data. Then Dr. Azuki in 1995 reported 28 cases. Then Bin Said reported 23 cases. And if you can see, most of these cases seems to be around the same time. I reported from the southern region of the kingdom when I was there, 25 cases of hemolytic uremic syndrome. This is just a quick look at these cases, the number of the patient, and this is the period when they collected the cases. Seems to be near to each other, and seems to be related, all these cases related to an outbreak during that time in that area. The complication, CNS and hypertension or chronic renal disease seem to be almost similar to the international figures. Also, the age seems to be similar also. Mortality, 3% and 4%, which is quite reasonable numbers. The last thing is, this is just a quick comparison between the hemolytic uremic syndrome caused by E. coli and one caused by Shigella, which is usually in the developing countries like Bangladesh, Pakistan, and also it has been, Shigella has been the probably, I detected the organism in five cases of my cases, and the other report, Bin Said was reported only four cases due to Shigella, and the other cases were unidentified. And this shows us how difficult it is to grow the organism at that time. So the age, the invasiveness, and the incubation period seems to be shorter here, and this seems to be a more severe disease with more complication. I think I'm going to stop here, and this is the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Nafa, for the excellent overview about typical HUS. It's a pleasure to introduce our next speaker, who is coming all the way from Toronto, Canada. Please welcome Dr. Christopher Litch, who is a consultant pediatric nephrologist at Sick Kids Toronto, and will be talking to us about atypical HUS. The floor is yours.
Dear Chairman, thank you very much for the kind introduction. Welcome. I would first like to take the opportunity to thank Dr. Al-Shaban and the members of the organizing committee for giving me the opportunity to come to visit this wonderful place. It's the first time for me to be here and to join you at this conference and also to talk about dear and favorite topic of mine to you about atypical HUS. I would just like to disclose that I have consultant contracts with two companies who have played some role in this game. What I'm planning to do is I would like to talk to you briefly about HUS in terms that you may not have you may not be used to as member of a spectrum of complement-based renal diseases, since I think this is the future, how we have to look at this disease in the future. Then talk to you briefly about the pathogenetic background of this disease, which is the alternative complement pathway, its activation and regulation. Then focus on the genes involved in HUS, in atypical HUS pathogenesis. If time allows, then add some work that I'm doing myself in my own laboratory, linking complement and platelets on the background of HUS pathogenesis, and then add a little bit about our clinical experience at SickKids, if time permits. the previous speaker already introduced in a lovely way hemolytic uremic syndrome as our disease of the day. So allow me just one slide summarizing the key clinical features. The disease was defined by a Swiss colleague in the mid-50s as the triad of thrombopenia, microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, followed by renal failure. And what I want to highlight is that at the beginning of the cascade of pathogenetic events, we find the injury of endothelial cells, especially in the glomerular capillary loops. Why there is still not well understood and even less understood in the context of atypical HUS. Subsequent to the endothelial cell injury, we find activation of the coagulation cascade with the subsequent generation of platelet-rich thrombi, and then obviously the thromboembolic occlusion of the glomerular capillary loops with organ failure. As already announced, I would like to put HUS into perspective. I think when you go back and review kind of overview articles of the past two decades or so, 2 to 3 decades, you will find kind of an ongoing debate whether there's a dichotomy or an ongoing spectrum with the overarching disease entity TMA or thrombotic microangiopathy, and that summarizing HUS and TTP, thrombotic thrombocytopenic thrombotic purpura, or whether all these diseases are separate and individual diseases. So the history is that people looked at those entities as separate, but I think, and based that on individual or details of knowledge that we collected in the past, as you know, HES being either D plus as an infectious disease, we heard about that, or then D minus, we'll talk about that, as a complement-based disease, TGP linked to the ADAMTS13 or von Willebrand cleaving protease deficiency. And also with a little difference in which organ systems are mainly involved, the kidney in the case of HUS and TTP affecting more or at least as well the central neural system, or whether this is really has to be looked at as a spectrum with the overarching theme of loss of endothelial cell integrity, with individual or combined defects of the complement system and or the ADAMTS13 system and other systems to still be identified. Candidates, for example, are the VEGF system, vascular endothelial growth factor system, and others to come up and already in the literature established and linked to this spectrum. So I think this is the way to look at the TMA side of things. And based on discussions we had over coffee yesterday, I added last night this slide to my talk. I think it is even more. I think HES is sitting in a spectrum of diseases that range really from the TTP end, if you want, to, on the other side, the MPGN end, and links probably a group of a spectrum of diseases manifesting in the glomerulus based on a combination of different pathogenetic roots, the complement system being central for it, but not the only one. The ADAMTS13 system will be part of it, the VEGF system will be part of it, and the the interplay of all these systems seems to be decisive which disease we are looking at and where the pathology precipitates. So this is from a very recent review that I participated in. It is a little challenging, it's a little provocative, but I think since you asked me to talk about future directions of this disease, I think this is basically taking away already one of the key messages of all my presentations today. Think about atypical HAS as a disease that is placed in a spectrum of complement-based renal disorders. All right, atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome. We learned a lot about this disease over the past decade or two or so, but it's still only poorly understood. And you know, different from typical HAS, atypical is the worst disease. It comes with a higher risk to develop end-stage kidney disease and even death. This is numbers from a very nice recent review from the Ramuzzi group from last year, published in the New England Journal. Pathology, pathogenesis is convincingly linked to the alternative complement pathway, and we can today explain about 50 to 60% of cases, depending on which reference you use, by mutations or inactivating antibodies resulting in a deficiency or functional defect in one or more of the regulators of the alternative complement pathway. The complement system. The complement system, as you know, is part of our immune system. It's part of our innate immunity and thereby part of the oldest defense system we have in our body. And the key is that we are looking at a balance between our own body, our own structures, biological structures, and which need to be protected, and foreign invading bodies which need to be defended. And so we are dealing with a delicate balance between inhibition and protection and activation in order to cause aggression against invading microbes, and if this balance is getting out of control and leads in uncontrolled fashion towards the activation side of things, disease happens that affects then also the host structures. Let's zoom in a little more. This is kind of a standard cartoon that I have to take you through. That's our understanding of how complement becomes activated in the body. There are basically three starting points at the top of the slide: the classical pathway, the mannose lectin pathway, and the alternative pathway. And then there's crucial merging points. All three of those pathways activate C3, which subsequently leads to the activation of C5, which subsequently leads to the activation of the steps of the terminal pathway with inflammatory consequences, opsonization, and phagocytosis of certain microbes, and the generation of the membrane attack complex and cell lysis again of microbes. Different from the classical pathway that is induced by antigen-antibody complexes and the mannose lectin pathway, also inducible by certain carbohydrate structures, the alternative pathway is constantly active and therefore requires a different regulation concept than the others. I just want to highlight one new aspect. It's not so new anymore, but it's not really appreciated, I would say, in the literature, and we'll come back to that a little later, that there is a bypassing activation pathway with thrombin directly activating C5, bypassing the C3 step. So be aware that there is the possibility that the complement system becomes activated not going through C3. So that seems is possibly something that is for the future important. There was something missing, but I can go on. I zoom in a little more. How does this alternative complement pathway now work? I told you different from the classical and the manosalectin pathway, this one is constantly active. And the starting point of the alternative pathway is that C3, which we have in abundant amounts floating in our plasma, is spontaneously activated by a process that we call tick over. That's a spontaneous hydrolytic cleavage of C3 that happens all the time, kind of similar to what happens in the coagulation system. And those activated C3 molecules then attach to surfaces. And this is a non-specific process. Any surface is covered in C3B with C3B. If the C3B molecule is then not stopped or prevented from carrying on, together with two more plasma proteins, factor B and factor D, it forms a complex, which is stabilized by properdin, another plasma protein. And those three together, the C3B, the active B, and the properdin form the C3 convertase complex. And again, if not stopped at this point, this generates an engine that cleaves and generates thereby, in a short period of time, a huge number of active C3 molecules, which we call the amplification loop. And this is really the heart of the complement cascade, and this step needs to be controlled, and if that does not happen, or it is not directed against our enemies, but also affects our host structures, then disease happens. Okay, so how does the body protect itself against that? You heard already this morning in context of, that's interesting actually, the plus HUS, the term factor H, and all of you are familiar with that obviously. Factor H seems to be one of the key regulators of this alternative pathway. And it definitely has three functions. The first function is to be cofactor to factor I, which is another regulator of the complement, the alternative complement cascade. I'll come to that later. Both together, factor H and factor I, cleave C3B and thereby inactivate C3B. A second function of factor H is to destabilize this complex that I introduced to you as the C3 convertase complex. And if the engine is not present anymore, you don't generate more C3B. Activation of the alternative pathway slows down. And the last, but not least, function of factor H is direct inhibition of C3B by competitive binding, and thereby preventing even the formation of this alternative, of the C3 convertase complex. Now, I could stop my talk with this slide now, and the rest is really just filling in arguments to support this cartoon. The concept that we have that has been developed by beautiful work of many, many people, and I'm really on one side honored, on the other side humbled to be here to represent this group of fantastic people worldwide doing this work on the pathogenesis, to elucidate and elaborate on the pathogenesis of atypical HUS. The concept that we have today is that the complement control, the control of the alternative pathway, is impaired on the level of glomerular endothelial cells. This is a cartoon of a glomerular capillary loop, the basement membrane, the endothelial cells, and here the lumen, all you need to know, I mean, kind of pushing the envelope a little bit, but not too much, is that alternative pathway dysregulation happens on the level of endothelial cells in the glomeruli, resulting in damage of those cells, kicking off the downstream events of of HUS, formation of thrombi, and subsequent occlusion of the glomerular capillary loops, similar or in parallel to what we know from HUS, and that is how we understand atypical HUS today. So now all we need to understand now is A, what are the details of this dysregulation of the alternative complement pathway in the glomerular capillary loops on the level of endothelial cells, and B, how to deal with that. And that's kind of the task of the remainder of this talk and also the subsequent talks then later today. So obviously we know not only about factor H, even though factor H seems to be really the key player, and I'll have later on numbers to support that. There is basically two big groups, and within those groups then now a list of, let me count, of seven genes that we can classify that participate in this complement control or the dysregulation of which. And if you want, you can cluster those genes and the mutations in loss of function and gain of function mutations. The loss of function mutations result in a loss of the ability to inactivate C3b, as I illustrated on using the example of factor H. It's also the first in the class here. But then there is antibodies against it. I will talk about it. There is another cofactor sitting on the membrane. There is factor I, which I mentioned already. And there is the latest player in the class, published last summer only in a new, lovely New England Journal paper by Remuzzi, thrombomodulin. And that's where a link between coagulation and complement is established or further established. And that's why I told you the thrombin link that has been proposed even 4 years ago is of more importance than we appreciate so far. And then there is another group, the so-called gain-of-function mutations, and those mutations result in a prolonged half-life of the engine that generates our C3b molecules, a prolonged half-life of C3 convertase complex, and that's the factor B and the C3. All right, first in class, factor H. Factor H is a abundant molecule. We have, you know, dependent on which reference you use, up to 500 micrograms per milliliter in our plasma floating, so we are filled with factor H. It seems to be important, obviously. It's generated by the liver. It's a large molecule, 150 kilodaltons. It's highly glycosylated, which also kind of raises the bar to express it recombinantly. It's made of what we call short consensus repeats or sushi domains, 20 of which you're seeing here lined up. And highlighted in blue is the N-terminus, which we refer to as the regulatory domain. That's where the function is controlled. And highlighted in red is the recognition domain, where factor H interacts both with surface structures, endothelial cells, for example, but also with C3b and C3d. Those complement components, which factor H is supposed to bind to control the alternative pathway activation. There's other binding sites, and we'll for sure later in our discussion come to those binding sites. But what's important on this cartoon is what you see here kind of listed towards the C-terminal end. That's all the mutations as of 2008, the date of this review, that are were identified up to this point in families with atypical HUS. And just by looking at the cartoon, what you can appreciate is that those mutations are sitting towards the C-terminal end, accumulating towards the C-terminal end, and obviously interfere with the C-terminal end where recognition and binding is mediated. So how can we get closer to the meaning of this genetic finding? So far, it's only a genetic finding, and we don't understand what it means. That was done in a beautiful piece of work published in 2007 in JSON, where an atypical HUS patient, an adolescent with an aggressive course of his disease, transplanted loss of graft due to recurrence was analyzed. And this patient was found to have a C-terminal mutation, a stop codon, resulting in the loss of SCR20. So he produced, and this was a heterozygous mutation, so he produced a mosaic of normal length factor H and reduced length factor H, which could nicely be shown on a Western blot study. And the authors of this paper then isolated, purified this reduced length factor H and used it for functional analysis. They did several things. One was the right bottom of my slide here. They tested binding of this factor H to endothelial cells. So they incubated QVEC cells and screened for factor H in green. Wild type factor H gives you a nice green signal surrounding those QVEC cells, which is missing in the situation where they used mutant factor H. Consequence, the mutation results in the loss of ability of factor H to bind to endothelial cells. And then they did a similar study using a more complicated technique. We don't need to go into the details. It's a BioCore assay where you use plasma, let it flow over immobilized proteins that you want to test, here C3b and C3d. And attaching proteins from the plasma give you an upstroke, and dissociation gives you a downstroke. Normal proteins, normal factor H, gives you high curves for both C3b and C3d interaction, and the mutant protein factor H from our patient gives you those crooked curves, which tell you also the interaction of this mutant factor H to C3b and C3d was impaired. So far we can say this C-terminal end really is important for binding. And we have shown that for endothelial cells and complement components. But we don't know what the functional meaning of that is, since only then disease occurs. So far, it's only nice biology. For that, they then carried on with what's known as the cofactor assay, which is basically an in vitro resembly of what happens in our body, the digestion of active C3b, which is shown on the left side in a cartoon, full-length C3b in two chains bound together by a disulfide bridge, and shown on the right side in an immunoblot example, full-length factor H at 110 kilodalton. Okay. And this was the 75 kilodalton band seen here. So this is full length factor H, C3b in its native state. And then you incubate C3b with the required cofactors, factor H and factor I. And then in two steps, cleavage happens, which is what's supposed to happen. The 110 kilodalton band becomes cleaved and in two steps, and you end up with three fragments. And if you follow that on Western blot, then you see that those smaller components here appear, which tells you normal digestion of C3b happens. Now, don't be confused. I'll carry you through. They applied this test to two situations using wild-type factor H compared to a factor H from purified from this patient, and they did two things. They looked at fluid phase, so absence of endothelial cells, and then presence of endothelial cells, again, QVEC cells. What they did was they did these, remember those immunoblots here? They did that in a series, in a time course series, taking from one in vitro reaction samples, stopping them, running the Western blot, and thereby kind of capturing what happens over time with the digestion of the C3B. And what you can see is that in fluid phase with wild-type factor H, the signal of the full-length C3B disappears and the breakdown products appear. That's what you would like to see. Interestingly, again, in fluid phase, using the mutant factor H, the result is exactly the same. There is no difference. So this mutant factor H does its job when you test it in the fluid phase, in plasma. However, if you focus on the right side now on those two panels here, using, again, factor H wild type and mutant on cells, the signal is a little weaker, but just follow what I try to show you, then you find with the wild-type factor H, again, decline and increase of the signal here. That's similar to the fluid phase. But now, using the wild-type, the mutant factor H on endothelial cells, the breakdown products appear much, much later. Here you have the first signals here early on. Here you find them only much later. That means you lose C3B digestion inactivation on the cells. And that is why you, in a patient then, develop HUS with all the subsequent events of the uncontrolled complement activation of your endothelial cells in the glomeruli. So there is not only factor H, but there's also factor H-related proteins. It's a family of five proteins that are encoded on the same chromosome in the same spot, 1Q32, downstream of factor H. It's a family of a total of six genes, factor H first and then 1 to 5. With a high degree of sequence homology, which predisposes this region for non-allelic homologous recombination and deletion events. This is kind of an emerging topic, that's why I don't want to skip it, since we learn more and more about those. This is the region on 1Q32, that's how they, the factor H and its related proteins line up here, first 3, then 1, then 4, then 2, then 5. That's why we find more and more now papers reporting on deletion events in this region downstream of factor H. And I don't want to go with you through the details. I have all the papers mentioned here, and you see they are mainly fairly recent, where through recombination events, certain parts of this downstream factor H region are lost, resulting in the deletion of either CFHR3 and 1, or 1 only, or 1 and 4, you name it. The table summarizes what's known so far, and there's for sure so far undetected deletion events. These factor H-related proteins are still only poorly understood. We know now from a paper that was published last year that factor HR1 is probably involved in the regulation of the C5 convertase. Different from factor H, which is working on the level of the C3 convertase, factor HR1 is working on the level of C5 convertase. But with the others, there is still that's still a wide open field. However, what we learned over the course of the past 5 years is that there is a subgroup of atypical HUS patients, and it's actually somewhere between 5% and 12% of our atypical HUS patients who have antibodies against factor H, the C-terminal end of factor H. And those antibodies seem not solely depend on, but have a higher chance to occur when you have a genetic defect of factor HR1 or 1 in 3. the link between the two events, the genetic side of things and the appearance of the antibodies, is not understood yet. But it is clear that there is a link, which is illustrated here on the in this cartoon. But what I want to share with you is that we are looking at a new subgroup, which we call deep HUS, deficiency of factor H-related proteins, and at the same time, presence of factor H, CFH autoantibodies. All right, I skipped this one and spent the next 5 minutes maybe just on a quick run through on the non-factor H family proteins linked to atypical HUS pathogenesis. There is first, and that's now an arbitrary order, the membrane cofactor protein MCP or CD46, which is expressed on fairly all human cells except for erythrocytes. And its function, as the name says, is again to be cofactor to factor I, like factor H, but this time it's a membrane anchored protein in the cleavage of C3b, and thereby to prevent deposition and activation of C3b on target cells. If you have mutations, you lose this ability and you have reduced C3b binding and cofactor activity, which results then bottom line in an surplus of alternative pathway activation on endothelial cells. Factor I is the kind of the main protein that cleaves C3b. It's clearly less abundant in plasma than factor H. It's about a tenth of the amount of factor H. Consists of a heterodimer. We won't go into the protein structure at the moment. And again, its function is to cleave C3b, also C4b, but we are not talking about the classical pathways at this point. But its function depends on the presence of cofactors like factor H or MCP. By doing its job, it prevents the formation of the alternative, but also classical pathway C3 and C5 convertases blocking the downstream events of the alternative pathway cascade. Mutations obviously result in an impairment of the inactivation of C3b. Factor B is part of the C3b convertase complex. And as I told you initially, mutations found here, it's only a very small number, result in a gain of function with an increased avidity of factor B to stick to C3, which results in an overactive C3 convertase complex with a prolonged decay and therefore with an overactive alternative complement cascade. And similarly, C3 mutations also are falling into the group of gain-of-function mutations, resulting in a increased stability of the C3 convertase complex with an overactive generation of C3b molecules. I would like to spend 1 minute on the new gene thrombomodulin, published last year, as I told you, which is known. It was has been known as a protein that has a role in the coagulation system. It basically is a counterplayer to thrombin generation, but it has also anti-inflammatory functions by inactivating anaphylotoxins like C3a and C5a. In a cohort of 152 HAS patients, seven patients, about 5%, were found to have thrombomodulin mutations and no other mutations, as compared to 380 controls. And it, what were found were heterozygous missense mutations. And in terms of function, I summarized it for you. Basically, the cofactor, thrombomodulin was found to be also a cofactor in the cleavage of C3b, like factor H and MCP, and mutant thrombomodulin molecules were not able to execute this cofactor activity. So we have a new player, negative complement regulator in about 5% of HAS patients. And this player, for the first time, formally links the coagulation and the complement system to each other. All right, maybe I finish off with this slide, and unfortunately can't have to skip the plated part. But this slide here summarizes you basically, again, out of the recent review from the Ramuzzi group published in the New England Journal last year, summarizes you in a nice way, and you'll see that in my subsequent talks again, summarizes you the genotype-phenotype correlation, so kind of the clinical information, the key clinical information that we have collected so far on HAS patients in whom one of the here listed mutations was found. And let's just go through quickly. About up to 30% of HAS cases, atypical HAS cases, are caused by a factor H mutation. Those patients have some but not a perfect response to plasma infusion. That outcome long-term is bad, and the chances to have a recurrent disease after transplantation is very high. Antibodies seem to be doing better. Antibody-carrying patients seem to be doing better, have quite a nice response to plasmapheresis or plasma infusion, have a, their chance to develop end-stage kidney disease is clearly smaller. And have a much better outcome after transplantation. Probably the best mutation to have, if at all, is MCP, where all these clinical outcome parameters are favorable. Factor I is similar to factor H, bad outcome. It's about 10% of patients. Factor B, I told you, this is a very small number of patients only, so it's hard to really make sense of the long-term outcome data. Similar situation for C3, even though there is more and more publications now coming up, 5 to 10%. And thrombomodulin, we saw that only one study, 5% of patients. So I don't want to skip now through all the slides to my summary slide, but I do it just without a slide. I think what I wanted to show you...
You should go quickly over the slides.
Can I do that?
Yeah.
Okay. So... So what I wanted to show you is that HAS is a disease... Atypical HAS is a disease that is caused by defect complement control in the alternative pathway on endothelial cells. We went in quite a detail through that. That loss of cofactor activity resulting in impaired C3b activation on or decreased decay of the C3 convertase are the key pathogenic principles. There is more and more evidence for an interaction of the complement and coagulation system in HAS pathogenesis, and I think that's where interesting research findings will lead us in the future to. I had to skip the platelet part, but we'll be happy to talk about that in the discussion. And my last slide, we don't have to go through, but I'll comment if you want, is just to introduce that yesterday again, after our conversations, is what we are doing at the Hospital for Sick Children in Toronto, trying to establish what we call an integrative concept of complement-based renal diseases, or for patients with complement-based renal diseases. We are trying to collect information on as many patients as possible using an international registry, which is online available. We established genetic workup for those patients, including the genes that I have listed here, and with the plans of genes to be added in the future. And our concept is to constantly update this list of genes and to retroactively test all samples that we have in our biobank and report on new findings based on new genes that we can test. We are participating in international treatment trials. We'll talk about it later more. And try to establish treatment or follow guidelines and further develop treatment standards at our own institution. And what I think deserves also to be highlighted is thankfully a successful effort now to establish parent and patient advocacy. We have a group established now in Canada which interacts with North American but also international groups, since there is a huge lack of knowledge. Patients and families are lost in a black hole of ignorance, and there is a lot of work that needs to be done. I can only encourage you, if at all, take that with you home, that there is a need to do something for these families as a starting point. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks, Dr. Christoph, for this interesting overview of this very highly advanced and complicated topic, but you make it more easier. Thank you very much. Now it is my pleasure to welcome and invite Dr. Hadil Mana, the consultant pathologist here in King Faisal Specialist Hospital and Research Center in Riyadh. And I'm sure you will enjoy her talk about the pathology pattern of HUS. Please, Doctora.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you for the nice introduction. I hope you will enjoy my talk after this sophisticated, nicely illustrated talks that you heard this morning. And I apologize for some of the repetition because there is an overlap between my talk and the previous two talks, but this is just for the sake of completion, and I apologize for that. So I'll start with a brief introduction, then just touch base on the pathogenesis, then we'll go to the pathology, and then we'll talk about the recurrent after transplant, which we are facing sometimes in our institute, and the relation of HUS with drug and the prognosis. Now, thrombotic microangiopathy is characterized pathologically by exclusive microvascular thrombi and clinically by profound thrombocytopenia, microangiopathy, hemolytic anemia, and variable signs and symptoms of the organ involved related to ischemia. And TMA include two syndromes, as you all know, TTP and HUS. Each of these syndromes appear to be caused by several distinct pathophysiological mechanism. And as you all know, in TTP, it's a thrombi-rich in bone Willebrand factor, which is related to platelets, while in HUS, especially the, in diarrhea-associated HUS, it's fibrin-rich hyaline thrombi. So it is different pathogenesis involved in these two pathology. Now, congenital TTP and acquired idiopathic TTP are usually caused by deficiency of plasma ADA, AMTS 13 activity, and HUS is usually caused either by infection with what we call it related to toxin, to E. coli, which we call diarrhea positive, and we could have the dysregulation owing to mutation in the gene encoding factor H and MCP factor I and factor B, which is related to diarrhea negative HUS, and this was very well illustrated in the previous talk. Now, the clinical distinction between the TTP and HUS does not always correlate perfectly with the characteristic pathophysiology mechanism associated with this syndrome. There is always an overlap between the two, either from the, like some patient with TTP having renal symptoms and some patient of HUS have like neurological symptoms. So it's not totally separated, two entities. And some patient diagnosed with HUS have been reported response to plasma exchange, although the basic understanding there is nothing to be removed but plasma by plasma exchange in most of the cases, if it's especially diarrhea associated. But however, they do respond to plasma exchange therapy, especially in adults who meet the criteria for thrombocytopenia and microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. Now, HUS, as already been mentioned, it's hemolytic anemia, thrombocytopenia, and acute renal failure. And HUS, as already been mentioned, divided to diarrhea positive and diarrhea negative HUS. And as this has already been mentioned, to the infection, and this is preceded by prodrome of diarrhea and fever. Now, the negative one developed without shigatoxin. It's not usually preceded by diarrhea, and it's sometimes seen in patient family member and has a pattern of recurrence, remission, and relapses. And this is the more aggressive one that can lead to end-stage renal disease more frequent than the diarrhea-associated one. Now, this is an old article, as you can see, in the Journal of Pediatric 19, relatively old. It's mentioned that HUS is seen in 9 to 30% of all patients with the toxin-producing E. coli infection, and approximately 40% of children with this disease require dialysis. Okay, and the mortality rate is 1 to 5% of patients with this disease, and the mortality rate is almost 0 to 30% with diarrhea negative HUS. Now we'll skip some of these for time's sake. And it was already been very nicely illustrated that the pathogenesis of this disease related to the infection. And for us as a pathologist, understanding the pathogenesis will help us in understanding the pathology of these kind of disease. And this already been mentioned and discussed nicely. And this is what we are seeing, actually, in this cartoon illustrated, that this endothelial cell gets swollen. The toxin and the factor that's related to that reach to the endothelial cell by endocytosis gone into the endothelial cell inside it and reach the endoplasmic reticulum. This will lead to detachment. First of all, this endothelial cell will suffer. They got swollen. That's why we are seeing congested capillary. Then there will be detachment of the endothelial cell with activation of the complement and formation of the thrombi. The pathological finding, it depends. Are we dealing with diarrhea associated, which is less severe form, which affect mainly in the kidney, the glomeruli, or we are dealing with the diarrhea negative form, which may involve blood vessel. And we all know that once involved the blood vessel, that the situation will be worse. We all know that when we do see this, that HUS can be overlapped with other diseases. And as a pathologist, I should not miss that. It could be associated with lupus nephritis, vascular lesion. We even see it with post-infectious sometimes. And we very well know that HUS or thrombotic microangiopathy, it's not part of post-infectious glomerulonephritis. So we should keep all this in our mind. Now, what do we see in light microscopy? There will be, maybe I'll just skip to the pictures. And as you can see, this is what we see. First of all, there will be endothelial swelling, so the capillary gets swollen and occluded by this swollen endothelial cell, and there will be formation of the thrombi, and this is the thrombi, how it's look under light microscopy with H&E staining, and it can be extensive and involve more than one capillary loop, or it can be very focal, and that's why we need, as a pathologist, need to be very patient in examining these glomeruli, not to miss a minor small lesion just starting. And this is even more extensive involvement of the glomeruli. And excuse me, we do use special stain that help us in identifying these thrombi. They have with this trichrome stain very red appearance, and we also can see some fragmented RBC that even extend to the mesangial and paramesangial area with evidence of keriorexis. And this is again just a thrombi, and you can see that this capillary start to get congested. And why this get congested? Because the endothelial cells so swollen, so these are like stuck or strangulated RBC. They cannot move about. And this with the special of the other special stain, which is the silver stain that stain the capillary black, we can see this thrombi nicely. And other feature that we can see what we call mesangiolysis, where the mesangium look empty looking. It's not really scarring. It is just because of the same process where there is subendothelial lucency in the because of the detachment of the endothelial cell. This can extend to the mesangial area again, and the process, if it's so severe, can also lead to acute tubular injury, a tubular necrosis. And this is what we call the mesangiolysis, or you can see that the mesangium, it is widening, but this is not scarring. This is because of the process that the part of the pathology of this disease is the fibrillary change within the mesangium, and you can see very clearly here that some of the capillary completely occluded. And we could have the ischemic type glomerular injury. Now if this is, we are talking about the capillary involvement, let's say if it's involving a larger blood vessel outside the glomeruli, then we'll have a picture which is related to the ischemia because the blood vessel is occluded. Now, if the process involving an artery that or an arteriole which does not have elastica, we will see the fibrinoid necrosis part. However, if it involves a larger artery which has the elastica, we will see the mostly the lucency and the mucoid-like degeneration in the wall rather than the fibrinoid necrosis. And of course, if we reach to the chronic stage, it's characterized by chronic glomerular injury, mesangial sclerosis, thick capillary wall, and maybe at this point, maybe it's really difficult to tell what lead to this lesion unless we have a proper clinical history. Some more pictures and start to have the mesangial sclerosis, and as we mentioned, you could have arterial thrombomicroangiopathy. And this is what we see in a small artery, a fragmentation of the RBC in the wall of the artery, and the most important thing that there is no inflammatory cell infiltrate. So this we can tell that this is thrombotic microangiopathy rather than vasculitis, and this is very important differential. And the wall can go all the way into fibrinoid necrosis. Now, immunofluorescent, it's very important to do it here because, you know, there are a list of differential, and this is fibrin stain in one of the blood vessel and a clearly staining. And if there is any other, there will be some IgM, some IgG, but it will not be something very striking like what we see with immune complex mediated process. Now, electron microscopy, this is very interesting and very characteristic. You will see the lucency, the subendothelial lucency, because these endothelial cells separated from their basement membrane. So this is what we see under the light electron microscopy. There will be some food process effacement, and definitely we should look for deposit, and there should not be any deposit. And with the time, the capillary wall, they can get wrinkled and can be obliterated by inflammatory cell and debris. And at the end, we'll have a picture which look like MPG and with double contour with mesangial interposition between the capillary wall. Excuse me. The other feature, we could have cortical pattern of injury, cortical necrosis, and it's often limited and may be seen in all form HUS, but more commonly with extraglomerular arterial involvement, which makes sense. But also sometimes we see only glomerular involvement and there is cortical necrosis. And this is the way that the whole thing is like ghost appearance, loss of architecture within the cortex. Now, recurrence after transplant, and this we usually get biopsy with this finding in a transplant setting, and we have to work it hard and do our homework to rule out all the possibility. Is it recurrence? Is it de novo? Is it related to drugs? And recurrence or de novo glomerular disease, an important cause of graft function, especially in children, and they can lead to renal failure and loss of their graft. The overall recurrence rate of HUS in renal transplant is much lower in the pediatric population. However, in children with diarrhea negative HUS, they do recur. And we know from the previous lecture why they do have, because they have the factor, they have the mutation. So you are removing the target organ, but you are not removing the pathogen. HUS recurrent after transplant is found to recur early, sometimes after transplant, and we do see cases within weeks, first or second weeks, they do recur. And HUS recurred during the first month after transplant in 60% of 25 documented cases. 7 cases had recurrence in less than 1 week, 8 cases within 1 month, and 6 cases within 1 year. And this is published in Pediatric Nephrology Journal. Now, is it de novo versus recurrence? As a pathologist, there is no way I can tell you that this is okay, this is because of this finding, I will call it recurrence. Or because I'm seeing this thing, it has to be de novo. There is no way I can tell you. It depends on the clinical history you provide me. If the patient had the transplant for HUS, that's most probably recurrence if we exclude other causes, like sometimes we see humeral rejection with the HUS-like picture, thrombotic microangiopathy. I'm talking about the kidney itself, not the systemic part of it. Drugs can cause thrombotic microangiopathy. So it depends on the clinical history you provide to us. Okay. I think we already mentioned that. And it's a big list of drug that can cause HUS or TTP. And I'm sure you are more familiar with this than me. But please, as a clinician, if you know that the patient on a drug that can cause this, please mention it to us, because this is the tool that can tell us what we are dealing with. And as I mentioned, and one of the important drug that it's commonly used, especially in the transplant setting, the tacrolimus and the sirolimus and the FK also, it used to be cyclosporin that it's blamed for TMA, but even tacrolimus proved to also be associated with thrombotic microangiopathy. Now, other viral infection like CMV and parvovirus also been associated with this syndrome. Now, relation of pathological picture to clinical finding and prognosis. Now, we have three pathological category: cortical necrosis, predominantly glomerular with little bit of involvement of the small arteriole, or predominantly arterial involvement. Now, the prognosis, I mean, it's obvious that if it's only limited to the glomeruli, the prognosis will be good. Once you have blood vessel involvement, the prognosis will not be as good as expected. And it depends on the size of the vessel we are talking about. Whenever we had a biopsy with HUS, usually I describe the glomeruli because it's very fancy to look at this very colorful glomeruli. The clinician will jump, how about that blood vessel? Please tell me, how about the blood vessel? I know that, but because I know why they are very much concerned, because the prognosis is very much different between if it's just the glomerular or there is involvement of the artery. Also, the time where, the age of the patient has an effect on that. Now, excuse me, and so that's why we can divide them into group one. Glomeruli show classical changes of HUS with milder involvement of the arteriole, and mostly frequently in young children. The second group, where there will be involvement of interlobal artery. So interlobal artery is a large artery. There will be fibrinoid necrosis and glomerular revealed either thickening of wrinkling because of the ischemia, because of the obstruction of the big artery, or will show also the fibrinoid necrosis. And we could have the mixed pattern where there is both a glomeruli and artery. And this is an interesting article. It's old, but I think it is reflecting what we are talking about. 29 patients were followed for 15 to 25 years for long-term outcome and showed close relation with the original biopsy finding. So biopsy has very crucial role in these patients. 10 of 11 patients with cortical necrosis developed end-stage renal disease. Sorry, 10 of 11 patients with cortical necrosis develop either end-stage renal disease in 4 or chronic renal failure in 3 or significant residual function abnormality. The 9 patients who had TMA involving less than 50% of the glomeruli were symptom-free and had only mild renal sequelae. So the pattern of involvement is really reflected on the prognosis of this patient. An older study that they said it depends when you are getting the biopsy. If it's early enough, maybe you will not pick up the arterial change because it will take like 2 weeks to develop the arterial change. So you'll have false impression that this patient will have a better prognosis. And I believe this is maybe related partly to the sampling effect. If you did not get a good size artery or if there is, I mean, you don't want to have your patient have a bleeding, but I mean, if there is not enough artery or arteriole, maybe your evaluation is incomplete because of that. So in summary, the presence of renal artery occlusion lesion determines the outcome in a given patient, and extensive glomerular change in themselves may not be necessarily significantly a poor prognosis as long as these changes are confined to the glomeruli and are accompanied by only minor arteriolar change. Exception to this rule happened. There are cases where there is only glomerular involvement and there are cortical necrosis, but I mean, there is always an exception, but this is the general rule. Even there is a cortical necrosis even when the arteriole at that area were preserved. With this, I'll end of my talk, and thank you very much for listening.
The floor is open now for discussion to all of our three distinguished speakers. So whoever has a question. Yeah. Go ahead.
Tafadhal, doctor.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. My questions to Dr. Lich. The international registry in your center is just wondering, we have, I think, substantial cases of atypical HUS in this country. I'm just wondering how we can, are you offering diagnosis and on top of registry? I mean, just can we send samples and looking for some sort of diagnostic help from your side?
Thank you very much for this question. So first of all, to be fair with all the other efforts, there is, of course, well known to you, an international registry in Italy. Professor Remuzzi is leading that. There is an effort in France. Paris, Chantal Laura and her group is leading there. There is efforts in the UK as well. So I don't want to pretend that there's no other international registries. What I am trying to do is to follow a little bit different from what the others are doing, where you have more kind of fragmented efforts, focusing on purely the genetic or mainly the genetics or mainly clinical information. I try to collect kind of an inclusive way follow a conclusive approach to enroll clinical information on the patients and do the workup. So what we are doing is, obviously, we try to enroll all the clinical information online, and then we offer through a lab at the hospital that is CLIA approved and therefore offers clinically usable data for $3,000 with a turnaround time of 6 to 8 weeks, full package with retroactive analysis, the genetic workup, easy to get hold of. There's forms that I could share with you. And again, I think the advantage is that we do not limit our efforts to the state of the art of 2010, but we keep going and add genes and commit to report on those. And the third
kind of pillar of this effort is the research that I didn't have time to go into, but studying those patients obviously will hopefully move the field forward, and that's our third effort.
For Dr. Christopher, thank you for your presentation. I just have two questions. Among those, the atypical HOS, which you have presented, the complement deficiency, is there different clinically between these each type, and what are the differences, like CNS involvement, other system involvement, and all of that? And how you will approach a newborn with HOS? Most likely the newborn will not be diarrhea positive, it's a typical HOS. So how you will approach that, and how accurate the complement measurement in the newborns, because even the level of the complement in newborns is not very accurate. So how you will approach those patients? Thank you.
Thank you. It's all very, very good and challenging questions. So the genotype